Hello and welcome to you all. I'm Mike and this session is about Power Query. I'm going to start off talking about what Power Query is in a second and then take you through some demos and some examples of how you can use it. Okay, as we go through the training, if you have any questions, then I'm quite happy for you to ask them. Now, you can't ask them verbally, but you can put them into the Q&A panel of WebEx. You should find a button somewhere on your screen. It may be on the right hand side, it may be up the top. Depends if you've gone full screen on WebEx, then you should be able to click that button and put your questions into the Q&A. I will try and leave time at the end of the course for questions, but if you think of something, if you have a question during the session, that's fine. Don't feel that you have to wait wait till the end of the session to get your question put in. Okay, so Power Query. Power Query has got two main uses. One thing that you use Power Query for is importing data into Excel from external sources. So that could be a database, it could be the internet, could be social media feeds, could be SharePoint. There are other sources as well that I've not listed. I've just picked four random sources there, but I'll show you shortly exactly where you can get data from. So that's one of the main things that you use Power Query for. If you need to import data from an external data source into Excel. The other main reason for using Power Query is for reformatting or tidying up data that you've imported. Some people call it data cleansing. Very often, when you have raw data, it's not in a usable format. If we look at what the screenshots that I have on screen now on this slide, the dates are not in the right format. The revenues need the dollar symbols removing. The data is not lined up properly in the right columns under the right headings. So I can use Power Query to tidy that data up. Now, Power Query isn't the only tool that you can use, but there are benefits, there are benefits of using Power Query to do that, and you'll see that when we get to that particular part of the training. A little bit about Power Query. It was written by Microsoft, and it's available as a free downloadable add-in. So it's not part of the core software of Excel. You have to download it as an additional program. It's a free program, but you have to download it. Now, that means that if you work at a company that restricts downloading and installing of software, you'll probably have to ask your IT department to download it and install it for you. It can only be used with Excel 2010 and Excel 2013. Now, if you're using Excel 2016 or Excel 2019, or you're using Excel Office 365, then the good news is you don't need to use Power Query. I don't want you to looking at this slide and thinking, but I'm using Excel 2016. Does that mean that I can't actually use Power Query and that I've wasted my time coming on this training? No is the answer to that. Microsoft have actually built in the functionality directly into Excel 2016. So if you want to be able to import data and tidy and clean data up, and you're on Excel 2016, then you don't actually need the Power Query add-in. What you do is you go to the Data tab on the ribbon, and you use the functionality that you will find in the Get and Transform section. It's the same functionality as you get with Power Query, it's just that you don't need to install a separate add-in. It's built into Excel. I'm using 2016 on this training. So when I talk about data, get and transform, if you're on the earlier version of Excel, then you will just need to think about it from the Power Query point of view. What you have to do, you have to download Power Query, install it, switch it on, and that gives you this extra tab on the ribbon, but all the commands that you see on the ribbon under Power Query are exactly the same as the commands that you find under Get and Transform on the data menu. It's just two different ways to access it, depends which version of Excel you're on. Most people still refer to it as Power Query, so even though, strictly speaking, in 2016 it's not Power Query, people do actually refer to it as that. So what we're actually covering is how to import data using Power Query or Get and Transform, how to avoid the million row limitation that Excel has. As many of you are probably aware, an Excel worksheet has just over 1 million rows in it, and you may need to import data that has more rows than that. So how can we get around that problem? How can we update the data when the data source changes? How you can create pivot tables from external data sources, and then how we can tidy up data to make it usable using something called the Query Editor, which is part of Power Query. So those are the topics to be covered. I'm going to come out of this presentation now, and I'm going to start the demo. So if I just run Excel, as I said, I'm using the latest version of Excel, Excel 2016. If I look on the ribbon, I don't have the Power Query tab. But that's because I'm using the version of Excel that doesn't need the Power Query tab. So I won't find it, and I don't need it. But if you're using 2013 or you're using 2010, then you will need the Power Query tab to be on the ribbon, to be able to use it. To do that, because it's not there by default, you go to File, then you go to Options, and then you go to Add-ins. File, Options, Add-ins. At the bottom of the Add-ins dialog box, you have Manage. You need to change that to COM Add-ins and click Go. And in that list of COM Add-ins, you should see Power Query. You put a tick in the box next to it and you click OK. If you don't see Power Query, then there's two possibilities. One is you're using a version of Excel that doesn't need it, so 2016 or later, like me. Or two, you haven't actually installed Power Query on your computer, in which case you'll need to go to the Microsoft website, download it, install it, or get your IT department to do that. And once it's installed, you then go through those commands I've just gone through to put the tick in the box. Once you've done that, you will see a Power Query tab on the ribbon. When I talk about data get and transform, if you're using the old version of Excel, then everything in this Get and Transform Data section you will find on the Power Query menu. So I'm covering that just to try and avoid any confusion, because I know we're going to have people from different versions of Excel on this training. Okay, so the first thing, having gone through the what it is and how to make it enabled and available, is to have a look at how to import data. I'm going to open up a file. So from my demo files, I'm going to open up a file called Sales Year to Date 2018 1203. And it's a CSV file. And as the name suggests, it is some sales figures from the 3rd of December 2018. So I'm using a date format, which is year, month, day. Imagine that I'm a sales manager for a company that makes and sells ice cream. Now, what I will say straight away is I'm just using sales as an example. It doesn't matter whether you work in sales, whether you work in IT, whether you work in HR, doesn't matter what industry you work in, doesn't matter what your job role is. Data is data is data. What you need to do is take away concepts and principles from this training and relate what I show you to your scenario, what you do in your work. So I have this file here, and it is information, it's sales information for all the sales in 2018, year to date, starting at the 2nd of January and going all the way through to the 3rd of December. Hence the name of the file, 3rd of December 2018. Every day, I need to produce a year-to-date sales report. So I'm sure my scenario is familiar to many of you. You have to produce reports. Maybe it's on a daily basis, maybe it's on a monthly basis, I don't know. The sales data is stored in our sales database. And every day, I log into that database and I export the year-to-date sales to a CSV file. It would be nice if I could export to an Excel file, but my sales database is quite old and it doesn't support export to Excel. So we're pretending that today is the 4th of December 2018 and the file contains all the data from the beginning of the year up to yesterday. So I have all this data. I think there's about 20,000 rows of data. And what I need to do is I need to get that data into Excel. The first thing I'm going to do is actually rename my file. So there's a reason for this, and you'll see this shortly. I'm just going to rename my file to be Sales Year to Date 2018. Unfortunately, I can't specify that when the data is exported. I get a CSV file where the name of the file is Sales YTD with the date. So I have to rename it myself. Once I've done that, I'm going to go into Excel and go to the Data tab. And on the Data tab, I'm going to click on From Text / CSV. If you were on the earlier version of Excel, and I'm not going to keep saying this, you would go to the Power Query tab and click on From Text. So it just depends which version of Excel you've got. But here it's Data, From Text / CSV. I then need to go and find the CSV file that I want to download and import, which is that one there, Sales Year to Date 2018, and click Import. It gives me a preview, says this is what the data will look like when it gets into Excel. It has automatically detected that there is a comma to act as the separator. So in the CSV file, I have a comma to separate the date from the city, comma to separate the city from the flavor, and so on and so on. But if Excel had not picked up the correct delimiter, you can change it. But for a CSV file, it's always going to be a comma, because that's what the C stands for in CSV, comma separated values. So you then click on the Load button. And what the Load button does is it loads the data into Excel, which is exactly what it's doing now. Where's it gone? Ah, it's not responding. That's a good start. Okay, let's close this down. Try it again. It was working about 15 minutes ago because I did test it. Just give me a second. Come on. Okay, let me just kill off Excel and try it again. So, start a new Excel file. Data, From Text or CSV. Go and find the Excel file, sorry, the CSV file I want to bring in. Click Import. And click Load. That's better. I can breathe easier now. Right, so what it's done is it's actually imported all the data just under 5,000. I thought there's 20,000 rows in my demo file. That must be another demo file I was thinking of. So just under 5,000 rows of data. It's been imported into the spreadsheet, put into a nice little table. So we have a table created automatically as part of the import. The name of the table is based on the name of the CSV file. And also on the right-hand side, it opens up the queries and connections panel, and it shows us that in this file, we now have one query, and the name of the query is based on the name of the data source. A query, by the way, is just a set of instructions that tells Excel where the data is coming from and how to import it. And we'll be looking at queries throughout this training. You'll notice, by the way, that it put the data into a new worksheet. I started a new Excel file with one worksheet in it, and when I did the import, it's automatically put the imported data into a new worksheet. Now, you can control where the data is imported into, but the default is import it into a new worksheet. So I'm going to save this file now. That's the first demo done. Nice and straightforward and simple. Just import the data. So let's save this file, let's stick it on my desktop, and let's call it sales001. Okay, I'm going to close it down. By the way, a query, when you have a query, the query is part of this file. So the query doesn't exist in a kind of bubble within Excel. No, the query is part of this file. And we'll be looking at queries further on the training. So that's not the last time you'll come across that term. I'm now going to do the same thing, but slightly differently. So start a new Excel file and go through exactly that same process. Data from text or CSV. Go and find the Excel file. I keep saying Excel file. Go and find the CSV file that contains the data that I want to import. But this time, instead of clicking the load button, which we know brings the data into the spreadsheet, I'm going to click the arrow next to the load button and choose load to. And what that does is it gives us some options. By clicking load to, it gives you various options as to how the data is going to be imported. So I want to import the data into a table. But I don't want to import the data into a new worksheet. I want to put the data into an existing worksheet, and I'm deliberately going to stick it starting at A3. Then when I click on OK, it imports the data, creates a table, creates a query, but it's imported the data into Sheet 1 starting at A3. So the difference there is by using the drop down arrow and choosing load to, it gives you more flexibility. It lets you choose where you want to import data into. Let's just save this file, call it sales 2, that'll do. Okay, and close that down. So that's how to import the data. I just wanted to go through that twice to show you the two different options when it comes to importing the data. Before I go on to the next demo, I also want to show you the different data sources that this supports. So if I go to the data tab, not only does it support importing data from CSV files and text files, it supports importing data from web pages, importing data from ranges of data in this spreadsheet, importing data from other types of files, importing data from various different databases, and you can see in that list there the different databases that are supported, importing data from Azure, importing data from various online services, and then from what Microsoft call other sources. And Microsoft add to this list on a regular basis. So you might find that one day the data source where your data is stored is listed here. What you choose obviously depends on your data source, but if I clicked on get data and I clicked on from database and I clicked on from SQL Server database, you then have to provide the server details, so the server name and the database name, which you'd have to get that from your database administrator at work. Or if I chose from Azure Data Warehouse, you then have to supply the server name, the database name. Just in the same way, when you import from a CSV file, you supply the file name, but obviously the file name is something that you would know, whereas the login credentials for a database you wouldn't necessarily know. Okay, let's close that down. Let's move on and let's have a look at importing data, not importing data, but updating data. Let's have a look at updating data or refreshing data. So today is the 5th of December. We've moved on 24 hours. Okay. So in the last example, it was the 4th of December and we'd imported the data from the start of the year up to the 3rd. And now it is the 5th of December. So this morning, I logged into the sales database and I ran another year-to-date export. And I now have another CSV file, which is called Sales Year-to-Date 2018-12-04. If I open that CSV file, that has got all the sales in it from the beginning of the year up to the 4th of December. So remember, today's the 5th, so it's got all yesterday's sales in it, which our original sales year to date 2018 didn't have. That only went up to the 3rd of December. So in our spreadsheet, we've got up to the 3rd of December. Okay. I'm going to close this file down and I'm going to delete the file sales year to date 2018, that's the old file. And I'm going to take the file that sales year to date 2018-12-04 and rename that so it is sales year to date 2018. Now, there's a reason for doing that, which I'll explain in a minute. So this is the file that's got the sales in it up to the 4th. Okay. I'm then going to open up my Excel file, the one where I imported the data. And this has got the sales in it all the way up to the 3rd of December. I know I'm primarily talking to a US audience, but that is because I'm in the UK, my machine has defaulted to UK format, but that's the 3rd of December, not the 12th of March. Just to confuse you. So what I need to do is I now need to update this data. I need to update this data so it includes the sales figures for the 4th. One option would be to delete all the data and go through the whole import process again. But I don't need to do that. All I need to do is right click in any cell in the table and select refresh. If I then whisk down to the bottom of the table, there is the updated data. So the new data has been added at the bottom. And then I'll just save that. Okay, so that's one way I can update the data. Just right click in any cell in the table and select refresh. I can do that also by going up to the table tools tab and clicking refresh. Or I can go to the query tools tab and click refresh. Or I can display the queries panel on the right hand side by going to data, queries and connections. and then right-click on the name of the query, which brings up a menu, and click on Refresh. So I've got about four ways that I can update the query. When I say update the query, you're actually updating the data by refreshing. What I'll also do is I'll reopen that sales year-to-date 2018 file, and I'll change an existing item. I'll change the flavor from the first row to banana, and I'll change the revenue from the second row to 300. Now, in the real world, of course, you wouldn't do that because this is old data. You can't go back when you're 11, 12 months on and say, you know that order on the 2nd of January, I'm going to change it from chocolate to banana. I'm going to change it from 200 to 300. You wouldn't do that. But I appreciate that not everybody is working in sales. Some of you may be working in, say, HR, where people change their name if they get married. People change their location if they relocate. People change their salary. So in that situation, it is quite legitimate that existing data may change. So I now need to reopen my Excel file, which has still got the old data in it. That still says chocolate, that still says 110. But if I do a refresh, it loads in the new data. So that's changed to banana, and that's changed to 300. Okay, so anytime you right-click and choose refresh, what it does is it goes out to the data source and loads in the data that's in there. It basically replaces the old data. So it's like you deleting all the old data and re-importing the new data. But instead of actually having to go through the import process, you're just reloading it in. It only works if the file name is the same as the file name when the query was originally set up, which is why I renamed the file. So if I change that file and stuck an underscore at the beginning, and then I did a refresh, I'll get an error because it can't find my data source. Okay, so that's why I've had to make sure that every time I get a CSV file sent to me via an export of my sales database, I have to rename that CSV file to be sales YTD 2018 to match the name of the file in the query. There is another option, and that is to edit the query, and that's something we're going to come on to shortly. Okay, so what we've gone through there is how to import data, different ways of importing data, and refreshing the data. I'm just going to pause for a minute because sometimes people have questions, and I know you can't ask them verbally, but if you can access the Q&A panel and you do have any questions, then feel free to put them in. Also just gives me a chance to just have a quick drink. And then we will move on. Okay. I'm going to now move on and show you the query editor. Okay, the query editor. I'm going to open a file. Again, it's a CSV file. I'm going to open the file called Orders 2016 CSV. It's just a CSV file where the data has come from our sales database. The CSV file has been created as a result of exporting data from our sales database. As you can see, it has got just February's sales in it. So this isn't a year-to-date example. This is just February's data. We've also got a dotted line across the top just to separate the headings from the data. And this is something that you do see quite often. If you've ever done an export from a database and then you've looked at the CSV file or the text file that is generated as a result of that export, you often see, not always, but you often see a dotted line between the headings and the data. That dotted line is really just to act as a as an underline to separate the headings from the data. Okay, you don't always see it, but particularly with older database systems, when you do an export, you often see this this dotted line. Okay, so the file is called Orders 2016. It was originally called Orders 2016-02 because it stores February's figures in it, but I've renamed it to Orders 2016. I have an Excel file here, Orders 2016. So if I open that file, this contains the same data that was in that CSV file. So the data from that CSV file that I've just shown you has already been imported into this Excel file. Hence the fact it's all of February's sales orders and the dotted line on row two. I need to create a number of reports from this data. But before I can do that, I need to reformat and tidy up the data. So, for example, maybe I need to change the city names so they're in uppercase. Now, you might be thinking, why would I need to do that? Well, that is what my boss wants. I need to change all the instances of New York City to NYC. Again, that's what my boss wants. It would be nice if it said NYC when the data was imported, but the data is stored in the database as New York City, and I can't control that. I need to delete the row with the dashes. I need to filter out and remove any rows where the flavor is blank. Sometimes, for some reason, it doesn't save the flavor in the CSV file. There's a known problem. And maybe I want to split the sold by. The sold by column is a reference to the name of one of our salespeople. So I need to split that into two columns, first name and surname. Now, this is something that has to be done every month. And if you think about it, a lot of that can be done in Excel. You know, it's easy to split this data into two columns. I'm not going to go through the whole process, but those of you that know about the command, you can use data text to columns to split the data into two columns. So Sally would be in one column, Jones would be another, Brian would be in one column, Cook would be in another. You can use a function. You can use the equals upper function to convert the text in column H to uppercase. And then you can cut and paste that from J to H. So that's easy enough to do with Excel. Just undo that. You can change New York City to NYC with find and replace. You can delete the row with the dotted lines on just by deleting row two. So the point I'm making is that the things that I need to do can be done quite easily in Excel. But let's imagine, let's extend this. Let's imagine that instead of five or six things that needed doing, and what I mean by five or six things that needed doing, changing the cities to capital letters, changing New York City to NYC, splitting the name into two columns, deleting out the blank, the row with dotted lines, deleting or hiding any rows that have got a blank flavor. So instead of those five or six things that need doing, you had about 20 or 30 things that needed doing. Again, if you know Excel well enough, you could do those things within Excel. But think how long it would take you. Most people who deal with imported data are data analysts, and their role is to produce reports and analyze the data. The last thing they want to do is spend half an hour or more every month, or it could be every week, tidying data up. If you could tidy that data up with two clicks of the mouse, and it takes a few seconds, just think how much more productive you could be. You're not spending your time tidying up the data. You're spending your time producing pivot tables, producing charts, and then analyzing that data. Now, you could automate that data tidying up with a macro. That's another way to do it. But that would require learning the automation language that's built into Excel, VBA. So that's where the query editor comes in. The query editor provides a quick way to do what we want. And at a basic level, there is no learning curve and it requires no programming. So how do you get to the query editor? How does it all work? That's what we'll look at now. Okay. To get to the query editor, go to the query tab and click on edit, or bring up the queries panel by going to data, queries and connections, and then right click on the name of the query and select edit. You'll notice in this file, the query is called orders. That's because originally the text file was called orders. So right click and edit, or go to query and edit. Now, if you're following along with me and you're using my demo files, because I did send these demo files through to Compliance IQ and ask that they be sent through to the people on the training. So if you've had copies of these files and you are following along with me, you will probably get an error right now. If you haven't been sent copies of these files and you want them, then I will give you my email address at the end. You're quite welcome to drop me an email and I'll send them out to you. But if you have got copies of these files, then you will probably be seeing an error right now. And the reason you'll be seeing an error is because it can't find the CSV file. Because if I click on the Home tab within the Query Editor and go to Data Source Settings, you can see that the query is getting its data from the file called orders2016.csv, which is on my desktop. So it's an absolute path to my computer. So if you are following along with me and you want to get rid of the error, then go to Home, Data Source Settings, Change Source, click Browse, and then go and find the CSV file called orders 2016. And what you've done is you've attached or connected the query editor to your copy of the file. That's why I was renaming files earlier, to make sure the files had the right name. Okay, so assuming you've done that, when you open up the query editor, and I'll just do that again, so I'll close the query editor and I'll open it up again. So you go to query and click on edit. And that opens up the query editor. When you open up the query editor, what you're looking at is you're looking at a copy of the data from the spreadsheet. And on the right-hand side, you've got the name of the query. So you can change the query name if you want to. And you're also looking at an applied steps box. And that applied steps box shows you the actions that get performed on the data. Now, the three actions that are already there, I'm going to come back to later. What you do is you build your query up by specifying or defining a set of actions. In a way, it's a bit like recording a macro. So if anyone knows about the macro recorder, it's a bit like that. So let's think about what we want. The first thing I wanted to happen in this data tidying up is I wanted to convert all the names of the cities to capital letters. To do that, right click on the heading that says city. From the menu that comes up, select transform and click uppercase. You can see there, before I click uppercase, you can see that you have a few other options. So transform, uppercase. And what it's done is it has, one, it's converted the text to capital letters, and two, it has added a step, and that step is called uppercased text. Now, if you've made a mistake, say you'd uppercase the wrong column, there is no undo in the query editor, but what you can do is hover over the cross, the little cross at the left-hand side, and click, and that deletes that step and returns the data to how it was before that action was performed. So let's go and do it again. Right-click on the column heading, transform, uppercase. You can also do that from the menu. You can click on, if I just delete that, you can click on the heading of the column that you want to perform the action on and go to transform, and in this case it's format uppercase. So you can do it in one of two ways. I'm not going to leave uppercase text as the name of the step, because in 6 months' time, when I come back to this query and it just says uppercase text, if I click on it, it doesn't, well, what it does do, if you actually watch what happens when I click uppercase text, you can see it's actually shown you what it's done. It's actually changed the text in the city column to capitals. But what if you had lots of columns and the column that it had converted to uppercase was off screen, it was over to the right? You wouldn't have actually seen that happening. So you would come back to this query in 6 months' time and you'd see an action or a step called uppercase text, and you'd be thinking, what is that action actually doing? So if I right-click on that step and select rename, it lets me rename the step, and I'm going to give the step or the action a more meaningful name. So I'm going to put convert city to uppercase. Just to me, that's more descriptive. Okay, so that's one action that I want Excel to perform. The next action I want Excel to perform is I want to remove the container size column. The container size column was imported into the spreadsheet because it was part of the CSV file. But I don't need that data. I don't need that data in any of my reports. I don't need that data in any of my analysis. So I'm going to remove it from the spreadsheet. Now, I know I could just go back to Excel and just delete column D, but that would mean having to do that every month. And I'm trying to automate the whole thing. So if I right-click on the heading container size and click on remove, that will remove that column. And again, removed columns isn't exactly the best description, so I'm going to rename that step. Remove container size column. Just makes it more descriptive. Next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to rename the column called quantity to be quantity ordered. So how much ice cream did the customer order? Right click and select rename. Oops, did I choose rename there? I don't think I did I? Just do that again. Right click. What's happened here? Not locked up on me, has it? Just bear with me a second. Let me close down this query. Keep the changes and go back into it. So query, edit. It's just Excel keeps locking up on me. Let me try that again. So right click and rename. That's better. And call this column quantity ordered. Okay, I can't spell quantity, so we try it again. Quantity ordered, that's better. Okay, so I've renamed that column, and I'm actually going to rename the step as well. Right click rename, and renamed quantity to quantity ordered. Okay, I'm not going to go through the renaming process of every step. I think once I've done it 3 or 4 times, you've got the idea. I also want to rename New York City to NYC, so I can right click on the city column and do a replace values, replacing New York City with NYC. And that has created a step called replaced value. Now, that particular step, unlike most of the other steps, that particular step has got a little cogwheel next to it. And if you click the cogwheel, that lets you see the definition of that step. So if I needed to change it, if I needed to change it to New York C, then I can do that in here. I don't have to remove the step and recreate it. So basically, any step that you see that has a little cogwheel next to it means you can click on the cogwheel, you can see the definition of that step and change the settings if necessary. Another thing I want to do is split the column sold by into two columns. Have first name in one column, surname in another. No messing around with text to columns here. I can just right click on the heading sold by, choose split column by delimiter. Excel has detected that there is a space between the first name and the surname, which is why it has set the delimiter to be a space, but you can change that if necessary, and then click on OK. So it splits the data. I'll rename these columns, so right click rename and put first name, and then right click rename and put surname. You can see what's happening. Every time I perform an action, it is in effect recording that action. Some of those actions or steps, you can go in and have a look at the setting. Some of them you can't, but all of them you can rename those actions. And I've chosen to rename a few of them, but I think once you've got the idea of what I'm doing, I'm not going to waste time doing them all. Okay, so question I see from, is it not showing NYC because you didn't use all caps New York City in your rule? Could well be, yes. So let me go back and redo that rule. So here's actually a good example, Claudia, where if I click the cog, I didn't actually spot that it hadn't changed New York City to NYC. Let's actually do it all in capitals. Click OK. There we go. That's better. So well spotted, Claudia. Thank you for that. Of course, if I had done the find and replace before I'd done the converting to capitals, then I could have kept it in lowercase or mixed case as it was. But yes, that was the reason why that it wasn't showing NYC. Okay, another thing I want to do, and I'm going to click on the last action here, because actually that's a good point to mention. When you go and perform an action, whether you do it by right-clicking on the column and performing an action from the menu, or you do it from the menu at the top here, it will add the step where your cursor is. So if I happen to be on this step here, convert city to uppercase, and I added an action, then it would add the action immediately below this step, which may not be what you want to do. So just be careful if you are jumping around, clicking on these steps, and then you think, oh, I'm going to add a new step now. Make sure your cursor is at the right position. I want to hide the rows where there is no flavor. So any row where there is no flavor, I do not want to be displayed in my spreadsheet. So I will go and filter those out. Just remove the blank. Okay, so filtered rows. Got the little cog wheel that lets me see exactly what filter I applied. So keep the rows where flavor does not equal blank. And here's one where I could actually rename it. Okay, so I could put delete rows where flavor is blank, or delete rows where there is no flavor, or something like that. And I want to delete the row with the dashes on it, which seems to have been deleted already. I don't know why. Hang on, let me delete that row there. Let me delete that step. That's better, yeah, because that row there, row one, didn't have a flavor. So actually, deleting the rows where there is no flavor, that would delete row one. But if I explicitly wanted to delete row one, because there might actually be a flavor in there, then what I'd need to do is go to Home, Remove rows, remove top rows, and specify that I want to remove just the first row. And that's now created an extra step, which again I could rename if I wanted to, call it, you know, remove dashed lines, something like that. And then I'll add the step to remove the ones that have got blank in the flavor. So what I've basically done is I've gone through and I've added about 10 actions. And those 10 actions will tidy the data up. So at this point, I'm going to come out of the query editor by clicking on File, Close and Load. And when I choose File, Close and Load, what Excel does is it basically reruns the query. What I mean by reruns the query is it goes through those actions. So however many steps there were in that right-hand column, it has just gone through those steps one at a time. And now I'm left with the data in the format that I want it. Okay, so I've got the names in two columns, I've got the cities in capitals, I've got NYC instead of New York City, I've lost the quantity, the container size column, I've got quantity as quantity ordered, I've lost the dotted lines, I've lost any column where there was no flavor, and I can now build my pivot tables or my reports or whatever it is I wanted to create. Okay, so I'm going to save that file and close it down. Okay, does close and load refresh the data, or does it just apply the rules to whatever data was last stored in the spreadsheet? No, close and load does refresh the data. Okay, so it closes, what it does is it closes the query editor, and I guess you would say it reloads the data, hence Microsoft calling it close and load. I suppose you could also call it close and refresh, but yes, it does, Claudia. Okay. Now, let's pretend that it's the beginning of April. Okay. I've logged into the sales database and I've done an export of March's sales. And that has created a CSV file called orders 2016-03, as in March 2016. So if I just open that file, we have got all the sales for March 2016. We've got dotted line, we've got the name of our salesperson in one, as one item, if you like. I was going to say one cell, but of course we're not working in a spreadsheet, so as one item. We've got the container size there, we've got the quantity, not quantity ordered, we've got the names of the cities, not in capitals, we've got New York City and not NYC. And we have no control over that, because that is how the data comes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rename orders 2016-03 to orders 2016. I'll actually delete the original orders 2016 CSV file first, and because obviously you can't have two files with the same name, so I'll rename this to orders 2016. The reason I'm doing that is because if I don't, then the refresh will fail, because the refresh will be looking for a file called orders2016.csv in the Power Query demo files folder on my desktop, because that is what's built in to the query. Okay, so the CSV file now has the same file name and is in the same location as the one that was used when the query was created. I'm going to reopen my Excel file, which was orders 2016, and I'm going to refresh the query by just right clicking on here and choosing refresh, and it's done it. So you can now see that we've got March's figures, because the month is 03. So that proves to you that it has gone out to that CSV file and it's imported the data in it from that CSV file, the March CSV file. But not only has it imported the data in, not only has it deleted all the old data from February and replaced it with March's, but it's also gone through those other steps in the query. So it's split the name into two columns, it's converted the city to capitals, it's done a find and replace on New York City, it's removed the container size column, it's changed the heading of the quantity column to quantity ordered, it's hidden any record that's got no flavor, it's got rid of the dotted lines, and I think that is everything. Okay. Claudia and everyone else, as I said at the start, if you do want to put questions in as we go, that's fine. I will look at them, and if they are relevant, then I will answer them. So those two questions that have been asked were 100% on point for what I was talking about. I'm always conscious when I'm running my training that somebody will ask a question which is slightly off point, in which case I will leave it till the end. But please keep asking questions if you've got any, you know, or save them till the end to the Q&A. It's entirely up to you. But what actually happens is when the query gets updated, the old data gets removed, gets replaced with the new data, and then all the steps in the query are performed. So instead of you having to delete this data out and then go through the import process again, importing the data and then having to spend 20 minutes, half an hour tidying the data up, if you just refresh, it reloads in the new data from that CSV file, as long as it's got the same file name, and goes through those steps. Now, mine was a relatively simple set of actions. Delete this column, delete this row, do a find and replace, split this data, change this column heading, and we're done. Imagine if you had a complex set of actions, which done manually took you half an hour. And I know that, you know, I'm not exaggerating there, because I've worked with people who do that on a monthly basis or even on a weekly basis. They get a set of data, they import it, and they then spend 30 minutes tidying it up, and it's the same things they do month on month on month, or week on week on week. And that is where the query editor comes in really, really handy. Okay, so I'm going to save that. I'm going to go back into the query by going to query edit, and that will reopen the query editor. And just to review the query editor, when you open it, it pulls a copy of the data in. That doesn't create two copies of the data. I don't want you to think that suddenly your Excel file has exploded in size, it's doubled in size. It hasn't. This is just a copy of the data that's loaded onto the screen, so that as you create steps, you can see the result of your action. And then you can say, oh yes, it didn't change New York City to NYC because, which of course is something that I didn't spot. But that is why it gives you a copy of the data, so that you can actually see the results of your actions on the data. If I go back to the first action, I didn't create. The first action was created for me. Whenever you import data from a CSV file into Excel, the first action is source. And all source means is link Excel to the source file. If I click on the cogwheel, it will actually open up this dialog box and show me all the settings. So it shows me where the data is coming from. In fact, it's a CSV file. The fact it's a comma separated file, etc., etc. You'll notice that the top row is not order date flavor container size, because at the instant that the data is imported into Excel, Excel doesn't know that the top row, let me actually go and find this, the top row of the CSV file, Excel does not treat those as headings. It just treats it just as data. So at this point, Excel doesn't understand that order date, flavor, container size, etc., are to be treated as column headings. So that's why they are actually on row one. Immediately the data has been imported, what Excel does is it analyzes the data in Excel, and it sees, in our particular example, that we have text as the first item, followed by some dates. Text, followed by text. Text, followed by text. Text, followed by numbers. Text, followed by numbers, etc. So based on that, Excel makes a decision that the items that were on the first row of the CSV file must be headings. What it would do if we didn't have any numbers or dates, I don't know. Maybe it would think that the data that was on the first row was an actual record of data. But usually you're going to have some numbers and some dates to differentiate the data type for each column. So it makes an educated guess that the data that's on the first row of the CSV file should be treated as headers. In Excel's language, it promotes the first row to be headings, and that's why the next step is called promoted headers. So if I click on promoted headers, it changes the data to say this is what the data would look like after that step has been performed. The next action is changed type. Now, if you look to the left of each column heading, you see an ABC. Initially, Excel is treating every column as text. That's why the numbers are left aligned and the dates are left aligned. So in the background, Excel does some analysis of the data, and it's worked out that what's in column B is dates, what's in column E is numbers, and F is numbers, and G is numbers. So what it does is it changes the data type of the data in those columns. So if I click on changed type, it's now changed column B to dates and column E and F and G to numbers. And not only has it moved the data to the right, but it's also changed the icon. So this is a column full of dates. This is a column full of numbers. This is a column full of numbers. And this is a column full of numbers, but decimal numbers. So everything in this column is just straight numbers with no decimals, and so is this one, but this one has got decimals in it. You can manually change the data type of any column just by clicking the icon and choosing a different data type, but that is what Excel has done. So whenever you import CSV files, it will automatically give you those three steps. The other steps are the ones I created. So if I click on the one that I called Convert City to Uppercase, when I click on that step, it now shows me this is what the data looks like after that step. If I click on Remove Container Size Column, it now shows me that the container size column has gone. When I say the container size column has gone, it's not deleted from the CSV file, it's just removed from the spreadsheet. So as I click on each step, it's showing me what the data would look like. And in fact, this is what happens when you either close and load, or you're in the spreadsheet and you refresh. What actually happens is Excel goes through these steps one at a time. It does it that fast though. It's not doing it like I'm doing it, really slowly. So it gets to the last step and that's it. And that is what your data looks like when it's gone through those steps. So I'm going to close this down. Okay. Now, I have been asked to create, I'm going to save this, I've been asked to create a pivot table that shows the revenue per flavor. Well, that's easy enough to do. I can just click into my table and insert pivot table, choose where I want the pivot table to go, just stick it over here, and drag in flavor to rows, drag in revenue to values, and there is my pivot table. So when you import the data into Excel, you've got to say, you know, why are you importing it? One reason you're importing the data might be because you want to store the information about the sales, the sales of ice cream in Excel, because people in your company understand Excel much better than they understand CSV files. Excel is much prettier to look at than CSV. Or it might be that you need to produce reports and analysis on that data. And I'm not saying pivot tables are the only way to analyze data, but they're one of the most common ways. So there is my pivot table, which is linked to this data here. If I refresh the table because I've got some new data, I've got a new copy of the CSV file, so I refresh this, then the pivot table will update. Let's just delete that pivot table. But now my boss has come to me and said, Mike, I now need a pivot table that shows profit per flavor. So there's two ways that I could do that. What most people would do is this. They'd add a new column to the table. Now, this new column does not get written back to the CSV file and does not get written back to the query. So what I'm doing now is not part of the query. They'd create just a new column in column J and put in a formula which says E2 minus F2. That will give me the profit for that particular order. And then the formula's copied all the way down the table. If I actually go back into the query, where's my query gone? Data, queries, there it is, right click, edit. We have not got a step in there to create the profit. So this, although it's part of the table, it's not part of the query. And then I can build my pivot table in the usual way. Okay, so drag flavor into rows and drag profit into values. And there is a breakdown of profit per product. Now, the downside of doing what I've just done is I have just added how many rows of data are in here. There's actually not that many. There's 109 rows of data. I have just added 109 formulas into this spreadsheet. What if I had 20,000 orders? So I had 20,000 rows of data. I would have just added 20,000 formulas into this file. And formulas can be the cause of Excel slowing down. If you ever, you know, open an Excel file and you're sitting there for 2 minutes whilst it's opening, and then every time you make a change to something, you get the Excel not responding message. And then every time you save the file, again, you're sitting there for 2 minutes and you're ready to throw your computer out of the window. I'm not saying formulas are the cause of the problem, but quite often formulas can contribute to the slowing down of your file and the file size growing. I'm not saying avoid formulas, because formulas are key to Excel. But if there's an alternative, then consider it. And that's what I'm going to show you now. Now, simple formulas like one cell minus another aren't a problem. It's when you get to sort of more complex formulas like VLOOKUPs. If you had 20,000 VLOOKUPs in a file, because VLOOKUPs require quite a lot of processing power, I can pretty much guarantee you're going to end up with a really big and a really slow file. So although what I've done here isn't wrong, there is an alternative. So I'm going to delete that column. The alternative is to build the formula in the query. So to do that, I need to edit the query, which I can do by bringing up the queries panel, right-clicking on the query and choosing edit. And then clicking on Add Column, Custom Column. Okay, Add Column, Custom Column. Giving the column a name, so I will call this one Profit, and then creating a formula. The formula is going to be quite simple in this case. It's going to be revenue minus cost. Unlike Excel, where you'd use cell references, so like B1 minus B2, in the query editor, you use the column names. And you could either type revenue minus cost, or you can double click on the name of the column from this list here. So double click on revenue minus double click on cost. And click OK. That has created a new column called profit, and the difference here is that we have, I know there's only 109 rows, but imagine, as I said, there was several thousand, but we have several thousand numbers, not formulas. So that's the difference. We haven't created hundreds of formulas. We've created hundreds of numbers, which are the result of the formula. So it's created an extra step, which it's called added custom, which you could rename to whatever you like. So new column profit, for example. And if I close down the query editor, we now have a new column called profit, which is part of the query, which means if I created a pivot table from this data, the pivot table data is coming from this column, which ultimately is part of the query. So what I've done is I've created a simple formula. Let's create another formula. Let's imagine that I need to have a column called tax. So if I was building this column in the traditional way, without the query editor, I would put in a heading and then I would create my formula to calculate the tax. Now, to keep this as a simple example, the tax is going to be 10% of the revenue, except if the revenue is over $100, it's going to be 20%. So, like all companies, we have to pay tax on the money that we generate, and our tax is paid as a percentage of the revenue. And the government rule is that we have to pay 10% of our revenue in tax, but if the revenue is over $100, it is 20%. So I put in a formula equals if E2 is greater than 100, then the formula is going to be E2 multiplied by 20%. Otherwise, the formula is going to be E2 multiplied by 10%. So that's just a standard if formula, nothing to do with queries, just a normal if formula. And the formula is copied all the way down. Rather than doing it that way, the better way to do it would be to do that formula in the query editor. So generate the tax figures as part of the query. To do that, go back to the query, right click, edit, and create a new column. Click on Add Column, Custom Column. Give the column a name, which is tax, and enter the formula. And the formula is if revenue, double click revenue, if the revenue is greater than 100, then revenue multiplied by 0.2, else revenue multiplied by 0.1. You'll notice that the structure of the if formula is slightly different to what you're used to. It's slightly different to Excel. So instead of having commas to separate each bit, you have the words then and else. Power Query has a language all of its own. And this is an example of a Power Query formula. It is case sensitive, so the if, then, and else have to be in lowercase. You have to type in any percentages as decimals because it doesn't like 10%. You'll see we've got an error there. Okay. I'm not going to go deeply into the Power Query language. I'm just showing you a couple of examples of the Power Query language. You could actually go on and on and on for hours learning the Power Query language. So I'm just keeping this at a basic level, just really to introduce you to it. So I'll click on OK. And we now have our column called tax. Close down the query editor. And we get this column called tax. So now, if ever I do a refresh, obviously in the CSV file, we don't have a profit column and we don't have a tax column. So when I do a refresh, what happens is that Excel in the background goes through all of those actions, all of those steps, including the creation of the formulas, the two formulas, the profit formula and the tax formula. But what you're left with is not 100 formulas in column J and 100 formulas in column K. You're left with the results of those formulas, resulting in a much faster, much slicker file. Okay, the last thing I'm going to cover today, because time is nearly up and I did want to leave a bit of time for Q&A, is how you can connect to a data source. If you remember back at the beginning in the introduction, I talked about the 1 million row limit. So what I'm talking about is in an Excel worksheet, you've got just over a million rows. So if the data that you're importing has more than 1,048,576 rows in it, then you've got a problem because you can't import all that data. It won't fit. Even if your data set that you're importing is much less than that, Excel has problems with large data sets. Now, what is the definition of a large data set? I can't give you a specific figure. I can't say when you hit 30,000 rows, you'll start seeing Excel slowing down. All I can do is say Excel can't handle really large data sets. 30,000 rows may be fine if it's just text and numbers. But if there's a lot of text and big numbers, it might not be fine. You might see Excel crashing. You might see Excel slowing down. So an alternative to importing thousands and thousands and thousands of rows is to connect to the data source. To do that, you go to the Data tab or Power Query, depending on which version of Excel you're using. Go to Get Data or go to From Text. If your text file, your CSV file's got thousands of rows. But what I'm going to do for this demo is I'm going to use a database. I've got a database set up with 30,000 rows of data in it. It's employee data. And I'm going to connect to that database. I'm not going to import the data. I'm going to connect to it. So I'll go to Get Data, From Database, From SQL Server Database, because my database is an SQL Server database. The name of the database, or the name of the server, is win10/SQL Express. As I said earlier, you'd have to find out the name of the database from your database administrator, the name of the database of the servers, Win10 SQL Express. The database is called employees, and click OK. Do not, first of all, click on employees there, that's the name of the table. Do not click on load, because if you remember from the beginning of the training, the load button actually imports the data, and it would actually import 30,000 rows of data. Click the arrow next to load, click on load 2, and choose only create connection. What that does is it creates a connection only query. So that has linked out to my database. It does not pull any data into this Excel file. The data is stored in the database, and I can connect to that data through the query. Think of the query as being the link between the database and this Excel file. If I go and edit the query, I can then edit the query in the usual way. You'll notice here we don't have source and promote headers and change data type, because it's a different data source. But as an example, I have got a column called salary. Let's imagine that that is our employee's annual salary. So I'm going to create a new column, which I'm going to call monthly salary. I'm going to create a formula, which is going to be salary divided by 12, and that's calculated every employee's monthly salary. I'm then going to come out of the query editor, and I'm going to create a pivot table. Insert pivot table. Because my data isn't stored in this file, I need to use an external data source. I need to connect to an external data source. I then click on choose connection, and I'm using the query called employees as the connection to my data. And I want to put my pivot table starting in A1 on sheet 1. So then I will drag in, what shall I drag in? I'll drag in home location. That is the office, the location that the employees are based at. So those are the offices where my company has a, or the locations my company has an office. And drag in monthly salary. And that gives me the monthly salary for each location. That is something that I could not do without the query editor. Because I haven't imported the data in, I didn't even have the option to create an extra column. So in the last example, I did have an option to create the profit column and the tax column as formulas in the spreadsheet, but because here I didn't bring the data in, I didn't have that option. So the only option I had was to create the calculation as an extra column in the query editor. Okay, I'm going to stop there. We have come to the end of the session. So I hope that has been a useful session for you. As I said, I did say I would leave you with my email address.